Good morning, good people. Welcome to our online worship service here at Friends Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. We are an open and affirming congregation here in the Brazos Valley, and we are so thankful that you have come to experience worship with us this day, this 15th Sunday after Pentecost. If you are a guest with us today, finding us for the first time, we're so happy that you're with us. There is a virtual guest form that we hope you'll take a moment to fill out. We want to know that you were with us today and have the capacity to respond to any requests that you might have about our congregation or about our denomination, the UCC. I want to encourage you to participate fully in today's worship service. Take a moment, if you haven't already, to download the worship guide for this service. You can find that on the website or on the post for today's service on Facebook or YouTube. It's your opportunity to follow along in the liturgy for this service and to engage as we experience worship together today. On that note, feel free at any time in the service, if you're following along with us on Facebook or YouTube, to share in the comments section when the time comes. The peace, our prayers, and reaching out to this community of faith however you feel called. We are glad that you're with us today. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. So let us be still together, knowing that God is God and that we are united in the Spirit, despite being separate from one another at this hour. Welcome to worship.
Please join us in the call to worship that you will find in the worship guide for today's service. We come into the presence of love together. We come to be transformed. Through the grace of God, our hearts expand.
Our minds are renewed.
Our relationships are deepened. Our practices of justice are refined. With humility and conviction, we come to discern the will of God. Let the way of Christ be revealed. Let wisdom be our guide.
Simple faith, simple prayer. You are God, you are
Shall we pray? Holy Companion, you did not create life in abundance only to have it hoarded and destroyed. You did not gift us with creativity only for us to fear change, risk, or new ideas. You did not give us the ability to dream only to have us settle for what is. Come and renew our imaginations and excite us with your divine possibilities. Make our hopes bold and our efforts brave as we seek to live into the life of resurrection. Amen.
At this time, we want to invite our students to get close to their screens at home for the student's message.
Good morning, friends. I hope you'll join me in waking people up, maybe in your house, maybe the neighbors, by telling them good morning on the count of three. One, two, three. Good morning! I'm glad you're with me. I have a question for you today. Have you ever seen a miracle? Jesus did lots of miracles. He walked on water. He turned water into wine. He healed sick people, and in today's story from the Bible, he feeds about 5,000 people with just a little bit of food. What I love about the story is that Jesus didn't really have anything. He asked his disciples, the people who follow him, "What have you got?" And they said, "We've got about five fish, we've got about five loaves of bread, and two fish." And he said, "I think that that's going to be more than enough." And they got all the people together, about 5,000, and they shared out of what little they had, and there was more than enough for everyone to eat. How about that? When we share, miracles happen. To share what we have is a miracle. Well, I'm going to need a miracle today because it's about snack time in my house. And I'm in charge of providing the snack today. But the thing is, I don't know that I'm going to have enough. I'm a little bit worried. See, in my house, there's four of us for snack time. Four people in my family. There's Stacy, my spouse. There's Mac and Ruthie, my children, and me. Well, there's actually six people in my family because we have a dog named Amelia and a cat named Frankie. But they're not a part of snack time. This is just for us human beings. But if I'm in charge of snack time, I'm worried because all I have is this one piece of bread. And I looked in the pantry and I found this big jar of peanut butter and thought, great, there's more than enough. But I looked inside and there's really not a whole lot in there. And in the refrigerator, there's just a little bit of jelly left, just a little bit left. So I've got to make this work. I think that what I learned from today's story is that this is going to be plenty. If Jesus were here with me, and he's always here with me, he would tell me, "What have you got?" And I'd tell him, "I've got one piece of bread. I've got just a little bit of peanut butter left. That's all that I've got in the jar. And, oh, that's about all the jelly I've got. Peach jelly. If you haven't tried that before on your peanut butter and jelly sandwich, give it a try." but this is all that I have. How am I going to make this work? Well, how about I share? Now there's enough for two people. Now there's enough for four people. And that is going to be plenty for Mac, Ruthie, Stacy, and me. I just made a miracle happen. This is great. I'll have plenty to share. When we follow Jesus, and you are a follower of Jesus, then we have instructions from Jesus to go out and make miracles happen. And one way that we can do that is just to share. You can do that. What's one way that you can make a miracle happen? What is one way that you can share? Would you pray with me? Repeat these words after me. Dear God, thank you for sharing your love with us. Thank you for giving us the power to make miracles happen. Give us the strength and courage to share what we have with everyone who needs to know your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Confession, repentance, turning one's life around to a transformed future. Forgiveness, resilience, opening one's life to a new moment in relationship. All this may seem impossible, and yet Jesus calls us to profound, ever-evolving change. It's a piece of our discipleship. It's what comes with following Jesus Christ. So let's take a few moments for self-reflection. I'm going to ask a few questions for us to ponder our lives, both personally and in relationship with the wider community. After every few questions, we'll pause for meditation and prayer. Where do we need forgiveness? Where do we need to forgive? Where do our lives intersect in the wider community with structures, practices, attitudes that deeply hurt our neighbors? Where must we seek forgiveness? Where must we seek to effect change? How have we been wounded by structures, practices, attitudes of the wider community that need transformation? How may we begin to forgive? Now, wherever we are in the ongoing work of forgiveness, hear this good news. In Christ, you are forgiven. By the grace of God, as the old hymn sings, morning by morning, new mercies I see. And hear this, beloved community, in the love of God that knows no boundaries, you and I are forever bound in relationship to the wider community. In these pandemic days of solitude, we may find ourselves physically isolated, but by the grace of God, we are never alone. With this assurance, you are set free to forgive and to extend mercy. You are empowered to do justice for yourself and for your neighbor. Thanks be to God. Now, before we pronounce the Amen, let's share our prayers. You can type your prayers in the comments so we can be praying with you and for you right now. And those prayers will also be shared with our church family on an email prayer chain this week. So today, we pray for mental and physical health, for those who find themselves in seemingly hopeless moments, and for each of us as we try to pull one another out of sickness in all its forms into healing and wholeness. We pray for those experiencing the transgression of racial injustice that sells all of us short. We pray for God's children who are unable or unallowed to be their authentic self because of the sins of homophobia and transphobia. We pray for everyone who is othered when society makes God in its image rather than in the image of God, God's self, who is love. We pray for people throughout the country and around the world who are fleeing from fires and flooding, for those who are running from violence and war, for all who are suddenly dislocated and even homeless. We pray for wisdom and discernment in how we care for ourselves and our loved ones, and how we spend, save, and share our gifts of time and money, in whether and how we engage or disengage on social media, in the examples we set for our children and youth, in how we live our lives. We pray in the name of God who gathers us this day for our staff, for our church leaders, for this entire body of Christ as we move forward in these difficult days. We pray all of these things knowing that we are bound together in the love of God, that we are never alone, that we are forgiven and set free and empowered to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Amen. And now I invite you to share the peace of Christ with those that you are maybe with right now, to share that peace in the comments section, and to let all of us know that you are here. The peace of Christ be with you all.
Here are a few of the things happening this week at Friends Church. If this is your first time joining us for worship, welcome. Please fill out a virtual visitor card that you'll find on our website so that we can get to know you a little better and answer any questions you might have about our congregation. Get connected with the Friends Church Youth Group. If you're a parent or a guardian of a youth in grades 6 through 12, we'd love to get your youth connected with our youth group. If you're not currently receiving emails and announcements, please send your contact information and the names and ages of your 6th through 12th grader to the church office. Sunday school has returned, and we're happy to invite the children and youth of our congregation between the ages of 4th grade through 12th grade to join us for Zoom Sunday school every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. For 4th through 8th grade, contact Camille or Justin. And for 9th through 12th grade classes, contact Alicia or Mary. There's more information in your worship guide. Also, don't forget, if you're an adult, join us for one of our adult Sunday school classes, Social Justice or Morning Manna Bible Study, both meeting at 10 a.m. This week on Monday and Friday, join us for our noonday prayer and check-in, an opportunity to gather with your church family to check in with each other and pray. And on Wednesday evening, join us at 6:30 p.m. for our time of prayer, scripture, and communion. This afternoon, Texas Impact is sponsoring a series of panels on faith and democracy, lifting Houston voices for justice. Go to texasimpact.org to find out more information about these virtual panels. And for more information about these and other announcements, please see your worship guide.
Good morning. I'm Dwight Baker, and this is my wife, June. And before we receive this morning's offering, we just wanted to mention what Friends Church has meant to us in our family. We came to Friends Church in 2014 when we moved to College Station, but we have been members of the United Church of Christ for all of our lives. So for that reason, we expected that Friends Church would be our home even before we entered the door. And it has been that. It's been great for us, and we have enjoyed the presence of other friends here at the community, and also the diversity of people that we have a chance to meet at Friends Church. So it's been an important part of our life for the past 5 or 6 years, and the United Church of Christ has been an important part of our lives for all of our married life.
The body of Christ is made of many members. We each come with our own offerings. We bring our stories, our talents, our resources, and all that makes us who we are to God. In service to love and liberation, in the knowledge and assurance that we each play a vital part in the movement of God. Let us bring together what we have.
Information will appear on the screen in a moment for how to text your offering or give online. God gives us continually. In each breath, we receive God's Spirit. Responding to God generously, let us give to God in thanksgiving. Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication that you'll find in your worship guide. Let us pray together. Spirit of life, you accept us just as we are, even as you lure us more deeply into love. You bring us into the company of others to expand our understanding. You send us prophets. You call us to courage. You companion us through wisdom, ancient and new. For all the ways your grace enables us to grow, we bring our offerings with gratitude and renew our commitment to pursuing what is good and true and just. Amen. And would you join me at this time as we pray together in the words that Jesus teaches us in one voice? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
continue in our journey through the Gospel of Mark, with Jesus now in Mark chapter 6, beginning with verse 30. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him everything they had done and taught. Many people were coming and going, so there was no time to eat. He said to the apostles, "Come by yourselves to a secluded place and rest for a while." They departed in a boat by themselves for a deserted place. Many people saw them leaving and recognized them, so they ran ahead from all the cities and arrived before them. When Jesus arrived and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, because they were like a sheep without a shepherd. Then he began to teach them many things. Late in the day, his disciples came to him and said, "This is an isolated place, and it's already late in the day. Send them away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy something to eat for themselves." He replied, "You give them something to eat." But they said to him, "Should we go off and buy bread worth almost 8 months' pay and give it to them to eat?" He said to them, "How much bread do you have? Take a look." After checking, they said, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. He directed the disciples to seat all the people in groups as though they were having a banquet on the green grass. They sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. He took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looked up to heaven, blessed them, broke the loaves into pieces, and gave them to his disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. Everyone ate until they were full. They filled 12 baskets with the leftover pieces of bread and fish. About 5,000 had eaten. Right then, Jesus made his disciples get into a boat and go ahead to the other side of the lake toward Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. After saying goodbye to them, Jesus went up onto a mountain to pray. Evening came and the boat was in the middle of the lake, but he was alone on the land. He saw his disciples struggling. They were trying to row forward, but the wind was blowing against them. Very early in the morning, he came to them, walking on the lake. When they saw him walking on the lake, they thought he was a ghost, and they screamed. Seeing him was terrifying to all of them. Just then he spoke to them, "Be encouraged, it's me. Don't be afraid." He got into the boat, and the wind settled down. His disciples were so baffled they were beside themselves. That's because they hadn't understood about the loaves. Their hearts had been changed so that they resisted God's ways. When Jesus and his disciples had crossed the lake, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored the boat and came ashore. People immediately recognized Jesus and ran around that whole region, bringing sick people on their mats to wherever they heard he was. Wherever he went, villages, cities, or farming communities, they would place the sick in the marketplaces and beg him to allow them to touch even the hem of his clothing. Everyone who touched him was healed. This is the word of God for the people of God. God is still speaking. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle within us the fire of your love. And may my words and all of our hearts together glorify you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. 1 year ago, at the end of August, John and I were in Portland, Oregon, for a wedding of some good friends of ours. In fact, we were the co-officiants, a first for us. It was a beautiful time with friends, and after the wedding was over, we decided to extend our stay and take an extra week of vacation. We drove from Portland down through the beautiful Oregon countryside and spent time at Crater Lake National Park, and then down to see the redwoods in Northern California before coming back up the Oregon coast to Portland. It was a wonderful, relaxing time, exploring some of the great natural wonders and scenic towns of our nation. Today, however, Oregon and California are on fire. The region that we explored is shrouded in yellow, orange, and red smoke and haze, as thousands of acres are being consumed by fire. The scene looks like something out of an apocalyptic film. In many places, the middle of the day looks like dusk. Communities will be devastated for generations. It's shocking to see the pictures on the news and compare them to the photos we took in some of those very same places. My heart grieves for that place and the people who call it home. But these events didn't happen in a vacuum. Choices were made over many years by government leaders and corporations and bureaucracies that have caused our environment and planetary health to suffer, to the point that we are now in a full-fledged climate crisis. Record-shattering fires in Australia a year ago, in the western U.S. today, record-breaking heat waves, increasing extreme weather events, all point to a planet on the brink. And at the same time that the health of our climate is imperiled, many people are struggling to get by in their day-to-day lives. Even before the pandemic threw our economy into a tailspin, there were millions facing food insecurity, housing crises, and lack of access to health care, all while others increased their profit margins beyond what any human being could ever use in 100 lifetimes. Something clearly is broken in our world and in our communities. In the Gospel of Mark, we've been on a journey with the peasant itinerant preacher Jesus and his band of followers as they encounter a world that's not so very different from our own. With resource extraction and poverty, hunger and social disruption leaving communities in crisis. Today, Jesus is being followed by a large crowd as he preaches and teaches and heals. And the crowd is hungry. There's not enough food to feed everyone, and the disciples don't know what to do. Their solution, such as it is to simply rely on the market to take care of things. Let them go into town and buy bread as if it were just that simple. But what's the alternative? I can imagine an exasperated-looking Jesus turning to them and saying, "Have you been with me this long and still you don't understand? Have you forgotten the stories of our ancestors when they were hungry? When the wilderness gave them manna and no one went without? Have you forgotten the Torah, the teachings that guided us from the beginning, that taught us how to build communities that took care of each other? Don't you remember that my Abba's creation has more than enough for all?" The world, Jesus reminds them and us, is made for abundance, not scarcity. There's more than enough for everyone and everything. If we live as a part of the creation and not pretend that we are the masters of it. There's a crisis in our world, just as there was at the time of Jesus, and Jesus reminds us how we're supposed to be living, reminds us how the Creator shaped and birthed the world to care for all the creatures that live upon it. It's a vision of the way things are supposed to be, a world where hoarding and greed give way to sharing and compassion, a world where markets and debt and extraction gives way to community and interdependence and mercy. We live in a world that is addicted to growth, more and more, bigger and bigger, year after year. The way that our economy is structured, gross domestic product has to grow every year or we're thrown into a recession. But the design of creation doesn't work that way. It simply can't support it. Unchecked growth that never ends in a living organism is what we call cancer, and it can be deadly. But it doesn't have to be this way. A few years ago, I came across a story, a parable, really, written by the author Michael Benefiel, called Bicycle Quick. Quilt Village. Ever since, I've never been able to get this story out of my head, and I hope that you'll be inspired as well. Everything in this story is true, except the part that hasn't happened yet. Once upon a time, a miracle arrived in a hill village in the southwestern mountains. Up from the broad plains of the field came a grandmother named Maria and a grandfather named Jose. They came on bicycles and carried backpacks full of wonders. From inside Maria's backpack came steel needles and colored threads and scraps of cloth from many different places. She taught the grandmothers of the village, which had a different name then, how to sew new designs in quilts with these new colors. The yellow of the desert, the blue of the river, the red of the sunset, the rainbow colors of the sky and sea and earth. Once grandmothers learned how to quilt, they taught the mothers, and the mothers taught their daughters. And word of the quilts began to spread from village to village. From inside Jose's backpack came steel and metal parts and small pots of bright paints. He taught the grandfathers how to make bicycles, with gears that changed and shiny metal parts, chains with strong links, pedals with wheels and spokes, baskets and lights and bells. Grandfathers taught fathers, and fathers taught the sons of the village. Word of the bicycles began to spread. Now visitors began to come and ask directions to Bicycle Quilt Village. From time to time, there were boys who learned to quilt and girls who learned to make bicycles. The villagers smiled and agreed that children should follow their talents and have a chance to show what they could do. Work rewarded the thought and efforts of each person. Quilts and bicycles connected them with each other. The villagers found pride in the making of useful and beautiful things, and they were delighted with the miracles. Sometimes they would ride their bicycles to the towns of the plains and buy more metal pieces and paints for new bicycles, and colors for threads and cloth for quilts. One day, a tempting offer came from the men of the city. The city men proposed to trade quilts and bicycles from the village for new machines that could sew faster. At first, most of the women said they liked the old ways. The work of sewing allowed for gathering and talking, listening to one another and sharing joys and sorrows, sometimes singing in harmony. What good would more quilts bring to the village? The women asked. Don't we already have what we need to keep ourselves warm and to trade with our neighbors? The loudest men did not share the wishes of their daughters and wives and mothers. They said that the women could find another time to talk with each other. Some quieter men worried that the new machines would be noisy and ugly, and thought the women might be right. The temptations of more wealth and power dazzled some of the men and even a few of the women. Many thought that the new machines would do their work for them, so they could relax and go fishing. They would no longer have to make an effort to work together and could leave the hard work to others. The Bicycle Quilt Village enjoyed their new machines at first. The machines were, as many feared, noisy and ugly and smelly. Still, the work changed and more quilts were made. One quilt began to look like another, because it was simpler to pick one or two designs and make them over and over. Women didn't find the work enjoyable, because the singing, talking, and sharing had stopped. Soon, the women of Bicycle Quilt Village began to forget who they were. The machines were a shadowy presence in the center of the village. The joys of shared creation and caring conversations, as hands and hearts produced beautiful and loving work, all that goodness began to disappear into the dark. The machines brought more than shadows and separation. to the Bicycle Quilt Village and its families. Soon, city men began to organize competitions for bicycles and quilts. Outsiders came to bring their expert words to the village. Big words like economic productivity and technological innovation and efficient deployment of the factors of production. No expert words like soul or spirit or community or interdependent network of mutuality were heard in the village. Jose and Maria, who might have spoken these words, quietly left and moved away with tears in their eyes and sadness in their hearts. Changes that came to quilts also came to bicycles. The people of Bicycle Quilt Village learned how to borrow money from city people. They began, one by one, to make ends meet by serving the machines and taking small advantage of weaker neighbors. They borrowed more, and they never seemed able to repay what they owed. A double crisis came. A fire burned the quilting place. After heavy rains, a flood came to destroy the bicycle factory, rusting the metal parts and burying the tools in thick mud. All the work stopped, though the lenders wanted to be paid anyway. The families of Bicycle Quilt Village gathered in the field and cried out in their loss and misfortune and confusion. They even called upon the king and the city people and the big word experts. No one came to help, except a big word expert who earned money by advising about disasters. The families of Bicycle Quilt Village looked for Jose and Maria to ask for more miracles, but they were nowhere to be found. They had gone to another place. The loud people found words to blame others for all the misfortunes of Bicycle Quilt Village. They pointed their fingers and found fault and vented anger. One by one, the loud people shouted and complained. Patiently, the quieter people listened, remembering that the loud people had said other things and promised happiness before the machines and the shadows had come. The quiet people looked at one another, waiting for the loud people to finish. The disaster expert told the villagers that they were hopeless, unable to manage their own recovery, and needed to borrow more money from the city people. The quiet people thought many thoughts, for they were also angry at themselves for allowing the loud people to bully them. After many days, each person had listened and spoken, and a silence came to Bicycle Quilt Village. Out of this silence, a young woman stood up. Her name was Marguerite, and she was the oldest daughter in her family, often busy helping her mother with the younger children. Marguerite said, "I have an idea for a new quilt design, and I have some leftover threads. By myself, I don't have enough material to make a quilt. Will anyone join me to make a new quilt together?" Before the villagers could answer, the disaster expert laughed in a mean way and gave a dozen reasons why this idea would never work. All were silent. I remember the old times when our work had meaning and we shared our lives with one another, said a young man named Miguelito. "I am not so good at quilting, Marguerite, but I do have some metal parts, and I remember how to make a good bicycle. Will anyone join me to make a new bicycle together?" The Bicycle Quilt Village people looked at the burned place and the flooded place. They looked at each other. Then the people who wanted to make quilts began to stand with Marguerite, and the people who wanted to make bicycles moved to stand with Miguelito. They waved their hands and bid a polite farewell to the disaster expert, who shook his head and left, bitter that the village would not pay him for advice. Instead of believing the disaster expert, the people trusted their own memories of the past and dreams for a different future. Day by day, they found their way back to a community rich in happiness and health, if not always up to date with the dazzling distractions of the city. Now, if you want to go and visit Bicycle Quilt Village, you have to drive your car to the end of the road and park. You'll find a bicycle waiting for you. You are welcome to bicycle into the streets of the village. The community is restored because the people followed the youthful hopes of Marguerite and Miguelito. They found a way to care for one another and to do the good work of making beautiful things together. Once a year, at the Fire and Flood Festival, they sing songs to remember Jose and Maria. They ask a clown to dress as the disaster expert, and everyone laughs together as his big words bounce around the audience. They sing songs for children who will become leaders soon and need to discover for themselves what work and community can mean. When neighbors ask Bicycle Quilt Village for help, partners go over to accompany them. They ride their bicycles and carry knapsacks full of miracles. They share ancient wisdom and open hearts and the promise that we can heal ourselves and our interdependent and broken world. Friends, another world is possible. And when we're on the stormy seas, when we're uncertain if we'll make it to the shore, Jesus is there with his hand outstretched, inviting us to take hold, to know that there is more than enough, that we are more than enough right now. So take hold of his hand and take hold, at least virtually, for a little while longer, of one another's hands. And together, we will make it to God's kingdom and to the table where there is more than enough. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Every darkness, bringing hope to you.
Friends, our worship has ended, but now our service begins. Go forth knowing that you are the body of Christ in the world, and God's world is waiting for you, is waiting for your compassion, your care, your love. Go knowing that you are enough, that there is abundance, that there is more than enough among us, within us. Know that you are loved and held in the arms of love, now and always. Know all this, and go in peace. Amen.